Tonight I'm going to tell you a story about one recent study. In the fall of 2017, Livia Tomova came to work in my lab. I'm Rebecca Saxe, and my lab uses brain imaging to study human social cognition. As a young child, Livia and her family were political refugees, escaping from Slovakia to a refugee camp in Austria. Years later, when she did her PhD at the University of Vienna, she chose to study how stress affects social motivation. When people are stressed, do they become more generous and empathic or less? Obviously, this is a really important question, but to test it, she used standard experimental approaches, like making people do a math exam or give a talk without seeing the audience. But these kinds of temporary stresses are small. It might be hard to disentangle from the pretty high level of background stress that college students already experience every day. So anyway, when she came to MIT, Livia and I talked career strategy. She could continue in the direction she was already going, or she could take a big risk, a big leap, try something entirely new, something no one else had tried. A week or two later, Livia had a pitch. She proposed that we study how the human brain responds to social isolation, whether people who are acutely isolated crave social interaction, the way that people who are fasting crave food. This project ticked all the boxes. It was new territory. We didn't know how much isolation would be enough to test the idea. Would people miss social interaction after being completely alone? No in-person or online interactions after 6 hours or 10 hours or only after much longer? In 2017, 10 hours seemed like the longest we could feasibly isolate people, because who would consent to isolation longer than that? And it would be logistically hard. We'd have to figure out how to isolate people for a whole day. We furnished a windowless room with Tetris and Sudoku, a sofa, and a fridge full of food. To image people's brains without stopping the isolation, the participants had to learn to get themselves into the MRI scanner alone, while a masked and gowned researcher silently watched. It would also be technically hard. The brain region that shows craving responses to food after fasting, the substantia nigra, is really tiny and deep in the midbrain, a place that is notoriously hard to measure. I've been a professor at MIT for 14 years, and I had never done anything like it, and no one had. The project had just one weakness, I thought. Would it ever matter to people's lives? Why would perfectly healthy, well-connected people ever become socially isolated? The project might have no practical applications. Three attempts to get the government to fund it failed. But sometimes we do science just out of curiosity. So Livia and I decided to go for it. Livia and a devoted team of MIT students conducted this experiment with 40 people. Each person had 3 brain scans, one on a regular day, one after fasting, no food for 10 hours, and one after isolation, 10 hours alone in our room. Like previous studies, we saw higher activity in substantia nigra when hungry people looked at pictures of food. But what no one had ever seen before was, we also saw higher activity in substantia nigra when isolated people looked at pictures of social interactions. Some people have asked me if this explains why everyone on Twitter was so obsessed with food early in the pandemic, and I don't think it does. The substantia nigra, and indeed the whole brain, responds really differently when food versus social interaction has been deprived. And other people have told me they thrived in lockdown. They loved the break from social interaction. And our data show that too. Different brain regions responded differently to the experiment isolation, some people more than others. So we finished data collection in the fall of 2019. Over the winter, we started writing a paper. We had devoted more than 2 years to this project. Would anyone care? And that is how I came to be writing a paper in March of 2020 about how human brains respond to acute social isolation, the most timely and relevant paper of my life. The paper is now in press, coming out this month. Livia has started her next job at the University of Cambridge in the UK, studying social isolation in adolescence. Maybe surprisingly, these days, teenagers report the highest levels of loneliness and isolation of any age group. The project raised more questions than it answered, as good scientific projects tend to do. How well does video chat replace in-person interaction? And Livia's original question still matters too. Does the kind of isolation and stress we've just lived through tend to make people more generous and empathic or less? These kinds of questions are what we need MIT science for.